Palmer's more likely to have a little notch in the leaf tip. It's got a little tiny hair in it, right? So that's more likely to be a characteristic of Palmer. And mature seed is small, black, hard. They're all, you can't tell the difference in the pigweed seed. They're all small, black, hard seed. The other weed that's in this family that's problematic is waterhemp, right? They both have male and female plants. There's a lot of variability within both of them. They hybridize. And so you can go into a field and see one that's got mostly Palmer characteristics, but leaf characteristics of a waterhemp and things like that. They both have male and female plants. The females obviously produce the seed. Right, and the females on a Palmer Amaranth, if everybody felt this, get this really, really bristly seed head. And I have to be honest, there's times when we can't really tell if it's water hemp or Palmer or sort of a hybrid until it puts a seed head out. Okay, water hemp, this I think is a male. So you can feel the difference. The male Palmer Amaranth doesn't have seeds, not bristly. The other identifying characteristics of Palmer are this big leaf that tends to be kind of diamond shaped. You see sort of widest right down there, right? Whereas a regular pigweed will be more ovate. Red root pigweed and smooth pigweed, our typical pigweeds, have a rough stem actually. And Palmer Amaranth and water hemp have smooth stems. Having said that, the Palmer Amaranth can have a little bit of variation there. Water hemp has more of a elongated, that would almost look like a water hemp leaf there. See the elongation on that? Compared to the one that I just showed you, but tends to be a little bit more elongated, almost like a smartweed leaf. And then the other thing we look for on Palmer Amaranth is these really long petioles, petioles longer than the leaf. So the leaf connects the petiole connects the leaf to the stem, so you fold the leaf over and you can get these really long petioles that red root pigweed do not have. The other thing, when you look at Palmer, sort of when it's got about this size and you look down, it's got this sort of rosette, arrangement of the leaves that water hemp really doesn't have. So one of the things about the whole Palmer and water hemp situation right now is it's we're doing better than the states, I think, to the west and north of us. So it's starting to show up here and there. This year we had, I think, four new sort of epicenters, whatever, where it's gotten started. You hope that it doesn't get to the point where you can't actually walk a field and pull it out. And if, you know, you're at the point here where it's pretty difficult to do that now. And you try to catch it before then, but if you don't, then you put a management plan in place in that field, and you kind of work with everybody else in the community to say, look, it's here, you're gonna have to watch roadsides and you're gonna have to watch around it and things like that. So that's kind of where we sit. And the way that it has come in are, as I said, it's coming on the feed products, it's coming on used combines from out of state. And it has come in, not to the extreme it has in other states, but on CREP and wildlife and pollinator seed. A lot of that comes from Kansas and places like Kansas and parts of Texas where some of that seed's produced. Palmer amaranth's endemic.
Other than transporting
the
equipment, how else can this be?
These are kind of sticky. I would think birds. I would think possibly deer, you know. It's not going to blow around like mare's tail does for sure. So one of the things I try to get across is if you're the neighbor, you know, you're not going to all of a sudden have, you know, a million seeds over there like you might have from mare's tail.
Big darn rains in the spring, water puts in that weed seed.
Oh yeah, it comes in. Yeah, water hemp and Palmer both. I've seen them come in when flooding. Yep. You know, the statement I usually make is water hemp and Palmer amaranth will have more impact on the profitability of your farm operation than probably any other weed. And a lot of other practices. Palmer amaranth in the South essentially doubled their herbicide cost of their herbicide programs in beans, and it went up in corn. Water hemp's no picnic either. Both these weeds will develop resistance to anything used repeatedly on them. They produce a lot of seed, 100,000 to upwards of a million seeds per plant. Palmer amaranth, they're kind of similar in that they both had to be controlled with post-herbicides when they're about this big. You got a little bit more leeway with water hemp than you do with Palmer, but this situation we do with giant ragweed, where we routinely kill it when it's this big, you won't get these weeds. You know what I tell people is that you won't necessarily know that you even have it the first time until you see it come through your herbicide program. It's not all, because you know it ends up in a field, your program's been dealing with mare's tail or giant ragweed or whatever, doesn't necessarily cover this, and some gets by it, you know, and then you come out this time of year, and what you hopefully find is a few, right? Not the field completely polluted, so you kind of want to be on your game.